As many of you know, Newcastle is now the home of a United Nations International Training Centre for Authorities and Leaders. UN Assistant Secretary General Nikhil Seth tasked it with capacity building in relation to disaster risk reduction and sustainable development, with a particular focus on the Pacific region. This morning's event came about when it became apparent that my good friend and colleague, Chris Young, who is my counterpart in CIFAL Atlanta, was coming to the country running a capacity building event for airport managers from this same region. This event was serendipitous because it connected to the issue of increasing sustainability through carefully planned economic development involving sustainable exploitation of the region's natural beauty to increase tourism. Chris's International Training Centre has a particular focus on economic development as a necessary step on the road to dignity and purpose in the existence for global citizens. And as he will shortly demonstrate, this is all but one part of a jigsaw of 17 pieces, which together comprise the internationally agreed future for the world's inhabitants. DRR, sustained development, and the related concept of build back better are inextricably linked. UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon signposted this connection at the landmark Sendai conference on DRR when he said, "Sustainable development begins at Sendai." But why? It's salutary to remember that during the first decade of this millennium, the world spent over a trillion dollars recovering from and reconstructing after disaster events. And in fact, that is now estimated to be somewhere between 200 to 300 billion per annum. Men, women and children around the world, as many as occupy Australia now, lost their homes, and about 1 million of them actually lost their lives. Setting aside the harrowing human cost for a moment, though, that $1 trillion represents a lost opportunity to spend money on something that would otherwise be more productive and more development focused. Of course, if you're one of the people that's being rescued or rehoused, then it seems like money very well spent. But from an economic perspective, there's an opportunity cost, or perhaps an opportunity lost. Money spent on recovery and reconstruction certainly benefits recipients and the enterprises directly involved in the reconstruction process. But in economic multiplier terms, that is to say the extent to which money trickles further through the economy, the answer is it doesn't very much. Given a choice, economists would recommend spending money on almost anything else in order to produce more widespread economic benefits. But what is Build Back Better, and how does it connect to disaster risk reduction? It's actually important to understand how to define a disaster, and the UN ISDR definition is really quite important. A disaster is a sudden calamitous event that causes serious disruption of the functioning of a community or society, causing widespread human, material, economic, and/or environmental losses, importantly, which exceed the ability of the affected community or society to cope using its own resources. You'll note that there is no reference there at all to human or natural disasters. And so by this definition, the aftermath of a war is treated exactly the same way as the aftermath of a cyclone. A chemical spill is treated in the same way as the societal stresses caused by forced migration. If the disaster component of DRR is intensely human, the element of risk that term is intensely actuarial and arises out of the presence of a hazard, whether that be the likelihood of recurrent extreme weather patterns or a tripping hazard on the pavement. The consequences of arising from the presence of a risk are not always equally experienced. If you're young and fit, with a good sense of balance and fast reactions, the consequences of tripping are less likely to be serious than they are if you're carrying a baby. It follows that risk is directly related to vulnerability, and that the most vulnerable are inevitably at the greatest risk of harm during extreme events. Whilst we can't always prevent those events themselves, as in the case of cyclones, we can help the vulnerable to help themselves by facilitating the construction of better homes, and we can certainly help removing tripping hazards on pavements. Such approaches have traditionally been thought of in isolation, often as a consequence of outrage in the aftermath of a calamitous event. Ban Ki-moon's statement linking DRR and sustainable development was in effect a clarion call for the systematic consideration of risk reduction as part of the recovery cycle, certainly from earlier disasters, but perhaps more importantly, as part of everyday living. I would imagine that many of us in this room have holidayed in Fiji during our summer breaks, and some of us may have been appalled by the torrential rain we've encountered. An unlucky few of us may even have been caught up in weather systems that have delayed our flights or disrupted our recreational activities. It's actually sobering to remember that these consequences are entirely foreseeable. Fiji is a tropical island. Our summer coincides with their cyclone season. Yes, this is inconsiderate, but it is something that we should factor into our own personal risk reduction planning, and yet most of us don't. We book very often on the basis of price alone, giving scant regard for the vulnerability of our chosen resort to extreme weather events. As consumers, we are in effect sending a signal that our own safety is not that important, that sun, sand, and swimming pools trump secure location and construction. And yes, we are outraged when things go wrong. So where is the link between DRR and sustainable development? Society, through its structures such as codes and compliance systems, patterns of urban development and land use, reflect the thinking of the day. The more basic the social systems, the more vulnerable that society is to the hazards it contains. The corollary is that beneficial changes made in the aftermath of a disaster can improve the resilience of that home, enterprise, or community at relatively little additional expense. The reconstruction dollar now becomes a resilience building dollar that ensures future reconstruction is minimised. UNISDR estimate that $1 spent on disaster prevention leads to between $4 and $7 saved on future reconstruction. That's between $4 to $7 that can be invested in productive economic activity, which will improve the lives of those in that area. It is no coincidence that the poorest in society are also the most vulnerable in times of hazard. Building back better is a truly constructive way to increase the quality of life of the poorest and provide progress towards dignity for all. Sustainable development really did begin in Sendai, and Chris Young will now put that jigsaw together for us. In addition to being Director of CIFAL Atlanta, Chris currently sits as the President of Protocol and Diplomacy International, which is the Global Protocol Officers Association representing practitioners in that field. He is globally renowned as an expert in protocol and cross-cultural communication and literacy. He has also served as the Executive Director of the Protocol School of Washington, which is a government organisation, and Chief of Protocol, and most importantly, Director of International Affairs for the state of Georgia, the latter of which he started and operated for two successive administrations. Please welcome Chris.
This morning, I'm going to look at the Sustainable Development Goals of the 2030 Agenda. But I want to say something at the outset and be completely fair. The United Nations, for all its wonderful attributes, if you think they have wonderful attributes, for all of its wonderful attributes, has one enormous flaw that may be actually a strength as well. The enormous flaw is that there are 193 member states of the United Nations. Now, there are about 50 of you in this room. If we got all 50 of you to agree on anything, it would be a monumental occasion. I don't mean general consensus, I mean unanimity. So to get 193 member states to agree on anything is an astonishing task. Keep in mind that when the United Nations was created in 1945, after the Second World War, its sole purpose was to what?
Stop war.
Literally, it was to stop war, period. There was no other add-on, no other attachment, no other vestige of something that somebody else wanted to do. It was to keep peace. But a few years into the, and I might add, there were only 50 or so members. Why? Because there were these great colonial powers out there, and I use great in the sense of large. I don't mean great as in, yay, colonialism. There were these great colonial powers out there that had huge swaths of the map that they controlled. And so they didn't let fill-in-the-blank country go and have a seat in the United Nations because they had a governor general or a viceroy or somebody there from Belgium or the UK or France or Spain or fill-in-the-blank country. So it was a lot easier when you had 50 people. I'm saying it was right, but it was a lot easier to come to consensus when you only had 50 nations. And then this whole idea started to spring up within the United Nations that the best way to keep the peace is not necessarily through large deterring armed forces. The best way to keep the peace is, among other things, making sure that a man or a woman has the dignity at work and is able to contribute to society and see a future for his or her family in a way forward, that a person is educated, and that we appreciate the cultural, literary, artistic, musical heritages of every nation, including indigenous persons within those nations. And all of a sudden this alphabet soup of UN agencies started to be created. UNESCO, which does just, preserves just some of those things I've talked about, the World Health Organization, the International Labor Organization, the World Trade Organization, they all in sequence started to develop this large United Nations bureaucracy. And from that point, everything that we're going to say, talk about in just a moment, is predicated on the idea that the United Nations said you don't just keep the peace by sending peacekeepers. You keep the peace by doing something, by celebrating artistic tradition, by finding a World Heritage Site and putting it on display for everyone to see and preserving its historical influence, preserving its heritage, by helping people create conditions where jobs can come to fruition, by making sure children are vaccinated and therefore healthy enough to go to schools, oh, by the way, build the schools, oh, by the way, find good teachers, and so it goes. So everything is predicated on that. Okay, now, how many of you have heard about the 2030 Agenda, the Sustainable Development Goals, just by show of hands? It's okay if you haven't, we're roughly half the room. How many of you have heard about its predecessor, the Millennium Development Goals, the MDGs? About the same. Graham, you haven't? about half the room has. Now, if so, we have to have a conversation about the purpose of the CIFAL network here. All right. So, the Millennium Development Goals were fantastic in this aspect. At the turn of the millennium, The United Nations, its member states, wasn't quite 193 then, but it was near it. They all got together and they said, we are hitting a monumental year, because, you know, humans like things that look, you know, symmetry, who to value, it's this great big sexy year. Now, Australia had its own, I mean, it was having the Olympics then, so they cared more about the Olympics probably than the Millennium Development Goal process. Be that as it may, the rest of the world was, oh, we're hitting the millennium, we need to do something. So they all got together, and instead of partying like it's 1999, I had to put in the Prince reference, just, you know, God rest his soul. So instead of partying, they said, we need to come up with some goals that will move the world forward. Now, there was nobility in this exercise, because heretofore, the United Nations had never really done something where it said, or, for that matter, even regional blocks of nations, where they identified in cosmic form the great problems of the world. Okay? But that's what they did here. They all got together in the late 90s and said, here are the great problems of the world. Now, if I asked you today, what are the great problems of the world, what would you say? Free-form association. Anybody?
Too many people.
Too many people, overpopulation.
Global warming.
Global warming and climate change and the effects thereof.
Hunger.
Hunger, absolutely. What else?
Poverty.
Displacement.
Water shortages.
Water. Anybody else?
War.
Biodiversity, or sometimes lack thereof. All of these were things that people stood up and said 15 years ago. And here's the reason why. Let's take poverty as an example. One of the Millennium Development Goals was, we are going to end poverty in 15 years.
Hooray.
Never mind you that it took millennia, maybe not that long, but definitely centuries, to create a system that saw the kind of poverty that we see in the world today. But we're going to sprinkle some dust on it, wave a wand, and in 15 years, no poverty. Now, I'm being a little bit flippant here, and on purpose, because I don't denigrate the United Nations for that, because somebody needed to stand up and say very rigidly and publicly, poverty is a problem. Climate change is a problem. Up until that point, it was pockets of people, certain nations, certain block groups of nations. This was a single, unified clarion call that cut through. So when I say it flippantly, here's what I mean. It was wonderful, but it was a wee bit idealistic. But is there anything wrong with idealism to start? Because they stood up and said, we're going to end poverty, we're going to make sure there's gender equity all around the world in all its forms. We're going to reduce the footprint of, and it had lots of different things. Essentially, it was, we're going to stop climate change. So these grandiose goals over 15 years would be accomplished. But here was the major problem, two major problems in that. Number one, it wasn't applicable to every nation. It was only applicable to what the UN called post-conflict nations. They never defined it. I don't know. I think all nations at some point in time have been in post-conflict. Maybe they still are. What they wanted to say but didn't say was developing nations. They just didn't want to say it. So they said post-conflict because everyone just fought a war or had some turmoil in their government or whatever the case may be. And the second great bugaboo in the room is, who is going to pay for it? And we're going to come back to that in just a second. So, I probably have gone all the way outside my slides now. How does this differ from the, y'all just follow me, this is not important. This is just all lovely script chicken scratch up here. So what's important about then and now, and we're gonna go with this, is back then there were two complete processes going on. You had all of the goals, and particularly how they integrated within the social fabric, and then you had this idea of sustainable development. Now, I'm not going to ask how many of you are on the faculty here, but I venture a guess. This is kind of a diagram slightly more simplistic of what faculty politics at a university can look like. This group up here is doing this, and this group down here is doing this, and this group over here is doing this, and none of them know what any of them is doing. And if they should pool their resources together, they would find out that they could do a little bit more together, or that their research meshes or something along those lines. Well, that's what was happening. These MDGs were noble goals, but they were very compartmentalized. You over here, you work on poverty. You over here, you work on sustainable development. You back over there, you work on climate change. Bye. We'll see you later. And that was a fatal flaw. And so the member states of the United Nations says we're going to change that with the sustainable development goals. And in 2030, it is literally one integrated, holistic agenda. It is, for all intents and purposes, inseparable from one another. When you look at one of the goals, I'll just goal number two, there are going to be things in goal number two that relate to goal number 16, which we'll look at in just a second. And that was on purpose. It is a fully integrated grid. Okay? Now, in the latter part of the first decade of this century, all the world leaders got together at the United Nations, the 193, and they said, we're going to have a 2.0 version document. What's it going to be? And heretofore, they had divided the goals into three great, big, huge spheres. Social development, which got most of the attention, economic development, which got least, and environmental stability, sustainability, was in the middle. But they were spheres operating on their own. So they decided to redraw and say, we're going to have five P's within the 2030 agenda, And they all intersect in some way. People, the planet, prosperity, peace, and partnership. Talk about in a second. And these create a symbiotic relationship that push the agenda forward. Okay? People, what does that mean? The focus is in poverty and hunger in all its forms and dimensions. The theory being, in development, if folks are hungry, they can't function. If you send a child to school hungry, is he or she going to be able to have the attention span to listen to the instruction from his or her teachers, to play correctly with his or her peers, to socially integrate properly? No. And the same thing with persons at home. If people are malnourished, they're going to be less productive at work, they're going to be less productive in civic society, they're just going to be less productive. Poverty is one of the two great linchpins of the entire sustainable development. We'll come to second in just a minute. Poverty is the number one goal. It is listed first. It was listed first in the Millennium Development Goals. By the way, of all the Millennium Development Goals, the reduction of poverty was the greatest success. Now, the reason is because of the number of people in China in particular who moved out of poverty over those 15 years. That was a gross number, as in large. It was a significant number that really floated that iceberg out of the water. And poverty has reduced substantively over the entire globe as global trading patterns have increased. Now, we could talk about livable wages. That is a fair question. Labor standards, that is a fair question. But what is undeniable is that even if wages are not completely fair, even if labor practices are not completely safe, that more and more people at least have a living wage. Whether or not it's a substantial living wage is another argument. Don't put another adjective in it right now. Let the UN get one thing at a time. The argument is at least they have some sort of wage. Poverty's the number one. And these are in no order. I'll come to the second one in just a second. Planet, exactly what it says. Protect the planet from degradation. Now, this can mean all kinds of things. The alarming rate at which biodiversity is decreasing across the planet. Climate change writ large and its effects. I mean, I was just in Ireland about 3 weeks ago, and Irish have finicky weather to begin, but they were saying it was the coldest winter that they could ever remember. It was in April. It was 2 degrees, and I got caught in a hailstorm in April, which they were all, it never happens. Well, how many people, where you travel in the world, people say things about the weather now, they say it never happens. What's happening now? It's like my grandmother was telling me last night. My grandmother, 85 years old, God bless her, she never finished high school because she had to go work during the Depression. And she called me the other day, and she was talking about how cold it was in April. And she said, "Son, I just don't understand the seasons anymore." And I said, "Why?" I called Granny. I said, "Why, Granny?" She said, "All these people who deny things are happening to our climate, all they need to do is step outside." It's an 85-year-old woman in rural South Georgia saying this. So, you know, people recognize these kinds of things. But that's the second large category. The third large category is prosperity. I should have put these in a different order because this is the second linchpin to the SDG. The idea that if someone has the dignity of work and that job produces in them a paycheck that allows them to do things and to take care of his or her family and to send their kids to school properly dressed and properly nourished, if that's there and they pay taxes and they are in civic society, whatever it might be, then it stops a lot of things. One example I like to use is I was in Nigeria not terribly long ago, and I was outside Kano, and I was with our guide, and we came across a little store at a crossroads, dusty little store, a dusty little road, and there were approximately 15 to 20 young men, I would say age 18 to 25, plus or minus, in that setting. And when we went on by, I asked the guy, it was about 2 in the afternoon, I said, "What's going on?" And he said, I said, "Are they on break?" He said, "No, they don't have anything to do." And I look at him, and it wasn't a matter that they were on break, that they were eating their lunch, it wasn't time to go out and have a smoke, it wasn't anything along those lines, it wasn't their day off. They literally had nothing to do. It wasn't anything, but there was nothing to do. There was no job, there was no future. And this man, who was Nigerian, who was with me, said, "And now you understand why a group like Boko Haram could come into town and promise something and they just get on the band with it. Because they see no future." And so the goals are predicated, and this word prosperity, don't let that be a signpost for, you know, the wealthy get wealthier and the poor get poorer. The essential thing here is that all human beings can find something to fulfill their lives and be contributing members of whatever society in which they live. And when you have a job, as we come to in just a second, most everything else begins to take care of itself. I don't know how it is in Australia, but in the United States, we have record low participation in the workforce. Record low participation in the workforce. I think the number now is only about 55% of Americans actually are working. And normally, historically, that number has been in the high 60s to around 70. Now, part of that is because we've gotten younger. Part of that is because university students who graduate can't find jobs anymore. And part of that is people are staying, people are underemployed. They no longer look for work because they can't find work. So all of that kind of stuff is wrapped up in prosperity. Then peace pretty much stands on its own, peace speaks for itself. Exactly. We foster just and inclusive societies that are free from fear and violence. Okay? And then the last of those is partnership.
Now, this was what was lacking from the Millennium Development Goals.
It was this writing, though. I get so confused now that I'm in a different place that speaks different language than I speak. And I have to figure out which verb tenses you all use. This is what was missing. It had all these grandiose goals, but it didn't really, truly, honestly involve civic society, corporations, universities and academic institutions, think tanks, foundations. It was, the MDGs were large, on a good day they weren't, but largely, here governments, go out and do this. Whereas the SDGs stepped back and said, if we're gonna get it done, everybody's gotta be in the same boat rowing along and singing the same song. And so there is a purposeful, meaty, concrete strain within the SDGs to go out and involve corporations, to go out and involve foundations and civic and philanthropic organizations, to go out and involve universities and the faculty therein and the students who are coming through. Because the idea is, one, we're going to need more resources that are not just money. We're going to need money. But we're not going to need just money. We're going to have person power. Men and women who are willing to roll up sleeves and work. This is their life's passion, or even they just contribute to it as part of their civic engagement. It doesn't have to be something they do for the rest of their life. And we're going to need money. Lots and lots and lots and lots of money. There are various estimates about how much the SDGs would cost to implement. I don't know that we could ever believe them, but the numbers in the trillions, and it usually is two figures in the trillions, and it usually is not U.S. dollars, and it's usually not 10, 30, 40, 50, it's a lot. No one really knows. But what is interesting about them is if you start to solve and chip away at one or two, the way they're written, which we'll see in just a second, you begin to ameliorate others. When you start to end poverty, the one right after poverty is to end hunger. Well, those go hand in hand. And so it's not that the expense, each one is discrete in its expenses. You can cover a whole spectrum of them. Take disaster risk reduction and resilience. Take things on the front end and prepare a place to meet those inevitabilities, be they natural or man-made. If you take those on the front end, you're also doing things to help them spur their economy. You're also doing things to help them save money after an event because they've already prepared for it and invest that elsewhere. On and on it goes. On and on it goes. Now, there are 17 goals. I promise you, I'm not going to give a discourse on all of them. However, I do want you to see what they are for those of you who have not seen them. Now, if you go to sustainabledevelopmentgoals.un.org, I think, or just Google Sustainable Development Goals, they have this nice gridded pictogram of this, and you can click on these, and when you click on them, they'll take you to all of the sub-goals. Here's the beautiful thing. There are 17 with roughly 175 sub-goals, and for the first time, they are applicable to all nations. The 193 member states of the United Nations voted to have them applicable to all nations. So Australia and the United States have just as much responsibility to fulfill the goals as Vanuatu or Jamaica or Estonia or Suriname. Doesn't matter. Fill in the blank country. Okay, but notice the first one, no poverty. Now, these are not necessarily ranked. They really aren't. Honest to goodness, they're not. However, we go back to this one. And if people start to come out of the grips of poverty, lots of other things can happen. So look at number two. No hunger. Now, notice here what they said. The previous goal said reduce poverty, reduce hunger. These goals are much more in your face. No poverty, zero hunger in the next 15 years. Is it achievable? I don't know. But the consequences of doing nothing are far, far greater than moving us anywhere along the forward end of that spectrum. So, you have no poverty, you come closer to having no hunger. And then look at the third one. If you eat correctly, chances are you'll have better, good health and well-being. These are connected, and that goes back to what I said about the expenditures of all these things. It's not just you throw a lot of money at one of them, and then you have to start over and throw a lot of money on the other. The hope is there's an integration of all of these that moves in as you go along. And that was purposefully written like that. And let me stop and give this as an example of how these are different this time. In good health, there are some sub-goals that relate to children. Okay? If you are a country that is developing, I'll use an example like Rwanda, or although Rwanda is an amazing case of what's happened post-conflict, it's extraordinary. It's a Burundi or Guyana or somewhere that their economy is still developing. They have a solid footing, they have a good, pardon me, democratic disposition, but they're still developing. This issue may be as simple as childhood inoculations, vaccinations. It may be as simple as nutrition so that they can go to school and learn. It may be as simple, and I say simple as in that's where they are, maternal health, prenatal screening to make sure that the infant mortality rate is reduced and that babies are healthy and thrive and that mothers are healthy and thrive. But a country like the United States or the United Kingdom, this might be childhood obesity. Two completely different ends of the spectrum, but the same goal is to improve general health and the subgoal for children. A country like Ukraine, it might be to stop child trafficking, which is the most serious issue for children in Ukraine. So the point of all this was not to be pro or prescriptive to a country, to a nation, but to say, here are the goals, now figure out where you are on the spectrum and go forward from there. Not a one-size-fits-all approach, but an approach that allows flexibility and malleability within a nation state. Oh, see, now you don't have poverty, you usually will not be as hungry, your health will improve, and you're ready to go to school. Now, I might add here, one of the add-ons this year or for the SDGs from the MDGs, which I think is brilliant, is it's a commitment to lifelong learning. And it's a rather controversial, in some parts of the world, statement that not everyone belongs at university. Now, I don't know how in the world that's treated here in Australia, but if you say that in the United States, that's nearly sacrilegious. Of course everyone can go to college. You can be anything you want to be, right? No, you can't. I mean, I don't want to stamp on anybody's dreams and make people think that I am anti-achievement. But no, you can't. We are not all inclined to the same aptitudes. We're not, and there is nothing wrong with saying that. And oh, by the way, we need people to work on cars. And we need people to work on mechanical things. We need people to do different sorts of things that we might consider, at least in the United States, as vocational or trade-type skills. In the United States, actually, you can make more money being a plumber than you can being a faculty member at many schools, especially in places like New York City, where they get $200 to $300 just to show up, and then another $200 or $300 per hour for what they do. So they go home at the end of the day having made $2,000 to $3,000 times about 200 to 250 work days per year. You do the math. Garbage collectors in New York City make over $100,000 per year. Now that's largely because they have a really strong union. But it's also because I don't mean all garbage collectors, but it also has to do with it's a job that nobody else necessarily wanted. They picked up a skill because they also rotate. They don't always ride on the back of the truck. They do some of the processing when it gets to landfills or those kinds of things. So they picked up skills. This is what this contemplates. It's lifelong learning says we can get to a point in our lives where we reconnoiter, just like the military realizes they did something wrong. So they all do a roundabout and say, we're going to change ourselves. We can do that. And especially among those, how many of you, this might be embarrassing, how many of you are 30 and under in the crowd? 1, 2, 3, okay, 30 and under. Everyone look at, raise your hand again. Look at one another. Graham, go ahead and raise your hand. You're about 30. Okay, the trend among that age group, none of you will be company men and women anymore. That is to say, you're very, very extraordinarily unlikely to work for the same place for 30, 35 years, get a pension, a gold watch, a pat on the back, attaboy, attagirl when you retire. It ain't there anymore, and it ain't going to be there anymore, particularly in the developing world. I'm sorry. So sorry. But you will. Most people will say, and most studies show, you will come between 6 and 8 different not jobs, careers in your career path. Why? Because there are jobs that have not been ideated even right now that you'll catch hold of as you go along.
There's water behind you.
What's that?
Water behind you.
Thank you. I keep going. It's springtime in the States, and there's pollen, and I just brought it over with me. I think. Okay. Now, that same premise of you moving along will necessitate that you get some sort of training to change your educational background to meet it. And I find that actually kind of exciting that there are jobs that haven't even been created or thought of yet that you'll have out there in the market. And Graham mentioned in my CV that I worked in protocol, which is setting the right conditions for business and diplomacy to succeed, not just which fork you use or which flag you put up, but something more broad. Well, there was no booth on career day at my university that said, come be a protocol officer. It was not that sexy, ladies and gentlemen. And so I got the portfolio handed to me because superiors on the food chain said, you'd be good at this. Actually, it was my governor who said that, which meant it was a command performance. I didn't have much I didn't have much say in the matter. He literally called me and said, I want you to consider this, which was code language for, this is your next assignment. And if you do well, you may have those opportunities. So anyway, quality education, I digress. Number 5, gender equality. Now let me stop right here. I just digress, I'm gonna digress again. As we were speaking about yesterday, there was a trend roughly in the 80s, played itself out in the 80s and 90s, a little earlier for some countries, a little later for other nations, to create ministries for women within the government. Now, I am paraphrasing a very prominent woman within the United Nations when I say this. I'm not projecting a male point of view. She said this, and I think that there is some validity to what she was saying, or it does say. When we created these ministries, what we gave license to have happen was the segregation of what was perceived to be women's issues. So something came up, and they said, oh, that deals with women. So they put it over here in this ministry that was segregated from all the other ministries, with the idea that this ministry would take care of it because it was an issue for women. And she said, in doing so, we missed out on the mainstream of policy because everyone just said, put it over there. What the SDGs do, while it has a standalone gender equality goal, if you go and read the sub-goals of all of these, what it does is it weaves this thread in every single one, thereby saying and announcing on behalf of the member states that it's not enough to have a separate ministry, that every policy issue should have, if appropriate for that policy, should have a string running through it, a thread running through it, about how to make this appropriate for both sexes. Wage, leave, access to capital, health, political involvement, whatever it is, we can go on and on. And so this is a fascinating one in and of itself. It does stand alone, but it's not just stand alone. The biggest place this shows up is in things like healthcare, political involvement, and economic development. How many women, for instance, are members of parliament? How many women are in the are around the board room? How many women CEOs are there? And this is a good time to mention. Remember how I said it was not proscriptive or prescriptive, nor was it one size fits all? This is a good time to mention that the paternalism of the MDGs was tried to remove it in the SDGs. What do I mean by that? It is not enough to say that we are working on women's issues on behalf of all women, because that means something very different to a woman living in Australia or the United States than it does to a woman living in Saudi Arabia. There is a vast chasm. When we get to equal rights in just a second, it's the same thing with the LGBT community. There is a vast difference between a person who is LGBT in the United States or Australia or Canada or France than there is with somebody in Saudi Arabia or even Indonesia, or somewhere like that, Malaysia. Vast difference. People are on different points in the scale. Doesn't mean one's right, one's wrong. It's just an admission that we're not all in the same place, so that the goals then will show up in different places. Clean water and sanitation. I think that's a straightforward one. We've done work with that. There's plenty on the DRR side that can relate to that on the front end. Number 7 is affordable and clean energy. So again, this is easy to tie into things like DRR, to climate change, to economic development. These are all kissing cousins. These all are related to one another in some way. Decent work and economic growth was number 8. Number 9 is industry, innovation, and infrastructure. And these two, number 8 and number 9, is where we spend a lot of our time as a center. And this, we do a lot of programs on infrastructure development, airports, seaports, roads, rail. We do a lot in programs to attract development, investment, and trade inbound in small places. We do a lot of work with cooperatives. In fact, we're having a huge cooperativas conference for Latin America in Atlanta in 3 weeks' time, 4 weeks, 3 weeks' time. And we'll have representatives from probably about 15 different Latin American countries there about how do you create economies of scale for, say, farmers within a place that maybe they can't do it on their own, but leverage together with others, they can make an impact. Reduced inequalities, and as we'll see in a second, this is a broad-spectrumed goal. Gender, race and ethnicity, indigenous persons, sexual orientation, religious identity, yes, D, E, F, all of the above. It is a look at how, or a look toward how nations should change their laws and policies to eliminate divisions that are created artificially based on an immutable characteristic, or in the case of religion, something that somebody chooses. Now, this one, just like the gender equity, is important to step back, and particularly for people who are in the proactive activist side of things, which I, great, super. But being an activist for some of these issues in Canada is not the same as being an activist for some of these issues in Yemen. It just ain't. It is not. And if y'all say ain't down here, I'm going to say ain't. It's not proper, but I'm going to put it in there. It's just wrong. You can't. You cannot assume. It won't work. And when you try to make it work, you all know what will happen. You will be completely discredited. You'll have no more opportunity within a country, and you may actually make matters worse. You may make matters worse in some places. Sustainable cities and communities, this fits directly into DRR, and this is what our sister center in Jeju, Korea, spends a tremendous amount of time working on. What I prefer, and what the UN actually debated using, was stewardship. Because every language group, and particularly indigenous and aboriginal persons, have a concept of being a good steward. That is to say, your ancestors, God, the ground, earth, somebody gave you something. And you then do well by the earth, God, your ancestors, and you return an investment on that land to give the next generation something better than you have. That is the concept of stewardship. In my world, I have a family farm that I've been on, our family's been on for generations. It must be sustainable. We may have no greater yield tomorrow than we had today, but it must be sustainable because we're still doing it. But the concept of stewardship connotes an upward mobility, that you are doing something good by that topic, that land, that place, that family, whatever, and then you pass something on that has then grown in value. And I don't mean money, but grown in intrinsic value. How many of you are parents in the room? A parent's innate desire is that they do better, that their children do better than they do. Whatever that means, that you are a steward of what you have to give to your children so that they can then exceed you. And you in pride can look and say, gosh, what a great citizen, what a great son, what a great daughter, what a great person. That's that concept. But I wish in sustainability we would think about stewardship, because I think that that is a resonant song to a lot of people. All right. Responsible consumption and production. Again, this in some ways go back to the biodiversity argument. Like, we overfish, we throw a lot away. Do we actually need everything we produce? Is it going to the right places? Genetically modified foods, what are we doing? That, it's all kinds of things are tied up in that one. Climate action. Now notice the verbiage has changed. No longer is it global warming, which is a bit of a misnomer because not everyone's going to get warmer. Tell that to the British Isles, because the British Isles are meant to be quite colder because of global warming or because of climate change. But notice it's even got change out of the way. It's climate action. This is a COP21 nomenclature change. That we need to have a call to action, not just a call to talk about change, because when you talk about climate change, it becomes quite academic. But when you talk about climate action, the word itself, at least from some mental, psychological connotation, spurs you to think in a different way. 14, life below water. There is a great, great alarm within the United Nations and other members, and particularly here in this part of the world with the Pacific Islands, about what happens beneath the ocean, and that we don't truly, fully understand the import of a healthy ocean. There's great fear in the United States West Coast, for instance, where they are beginning to see things wash up from Fukushima, and what has happened in the transit, and how much more is left to come. Because the ocean really truly is probably the last frontier on Earth. I mean, underwater. This is a big, big, huge one. Oh, and if, you know, we're equal. If you're going to have life on water, you got to have life on land, right? We're very equitable on this. Remember, go back, we reduce inequalities. So we said those that walk under the, or those that exist under the water are as important as those on top of the land, or on top of the water. And then peace, justice, and strong institutions. We do a tremendous amount of work on this in training judges, judicial officers. We talk about free and fair elections, democratic principles here. But you have to be careful not to be paternalistic on these sorts of things, but consider where people are, and where they've come from, and where they want to go. Not where you want them to go necessarily, although there can be some of that, but where they want to go as society. And then the catch-all. All those other things we don't know about goes in here so we can recruit partners. But again, this is a nod, a tip of the hat, a salute, that this is not something that governments can do alone. But maybe more brutally honest, it's not something that governments are competent to do alone. Because within governments, it's not the entire knowledge base and infrastructure to meet these. And then sometimes we want to cut off our nose to spite our face. Some folks don't want to have anything to do with corporations. Corporations aren't going anywhere. So if corporations are going to be here, is it better to put them off on an island, or is it better to bring them in a partnership and find a way that they can help effectuate these goals? Very quickly, let me show you how they come down. This is the poverty. What you do when you approach each one of these, when you go online, they will have targets. And there are only two listed here, but there are multiple ones. So it's eradicate extreme poverty, and down here it's halve by national standards. And da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Notice here, two different standards. Eradicate by global standards, meaning global standards have a lower threshold. Halve by national standards.
Meaning, it's not just enough to get rid of it by whatever the global standard, whatever the GDP of your country is, or excuse me, whatever the per capita income of your country is, and you say, okay, below $20,000 is the poverty line, or maybe they say the world standard is $3,000 a year, I don't know, whatever number they come up with. Here, it makes you be even more aggressive. So again, there's a lot of malleability. And then I'll tell you this. The SDGs are but the SDGs are heavily focused on the following. Rural populations. Now, why in the world might they say rural populations when the world is increasingly more urban? Because the world is increasingly more urban, it sure is easy to forget those among us who live in rural areas. Or you can keep waddle along rural. See, I saw all those signs out in my house. I'm from a rural area. This sings a little bit to my heart because people still live in rural areas. And it's important. And the United Nations is going out of its way to say, yes, so much of this deals with urban, but it's not enough. We have to look at what's happening in rural populations. Women and children are a focal point. We've already seen that. Indigenous peoples are an extraordinary touch point within these goals, particularly as it relates to access to services, equity, access to capital for investment, those sorts of things. Now, this is tricky. This is extremely tricky. And I'm not telling Australia anything that it doesn't already know. Same thing I would say to Canada or the United States or New Zealand or anywhere that has an indigenous population. There is always a struggle to find the right policy balance that is both respectful and inclusive, but also forwards national objectives. And there's no one-size-fits-all approach with this, but the goals are predicated in Indigenous peoples being brought along in the process. I don't mean brought along kicking, drag, drug, and screaming. I mean involved in the first instance. Linguistic and cultural minorities, huge issue all over the world. Graham and I had conversations this weekend, and you would be hard pressed to convince me that the problems of the world aren't universal. Problems of class, economic class, and problems of race, I think they're universal. It's just a matter of where they're applied. You can go to a country that is a poor country. And within that country, there are people who are poor who will find people who are poorer than them and create class distinctions. There are people within ethnic groups that even within those ethnic groups will create ethnic distinctions within those groups based on accent, because there's a lot of people where I'm from who think I'm stupid because of my accent. Great, super. I told Graham last night, that makes me happy when people do that because I like to just sit back and wait till I can punch them right between the eyes with some intellectual tour de force. I haven't done it today yet, but maybe by the end of the day. But minorities are everywhere. And I don't mean the minorities we think about, but even within groups within homogeneous nations, there are minority groups in the way people, city folk and rural folk. How people talk, not talk, what people's last names are. And then it just gets exacerbated from there. People with disabilities, in fact, our founding father, if you will, of our CIFAL Quito Center has been the chief draft person for the UN Convention on Disabilities, which is just like the UN Convention on Human Rights, the UN Convention on fill in the blank. It hasn't been ratified yet, but soon it probably will be. And then people in remote and conflict areas. And that's where the catchment area of CIFAL Newcastle can certainly come in the Pacific Islands, because they are remote. They might be easier for you to get to than I am, but they are remote by definition. And then migrants. Now, I don't know what the debate is in Australia about migration, but I have a feeling there's at least a mimic of the debate in the United States. Please don't ask me about Donald Trump in the Q&A session. I refuse to answer any of those questions, especially while the camera is rolling, so don't do it! I'm not going to be baited. I'm not going to be... No. But, by the way, he's not the only candidate
that have that similar kind of refrain, and he's not the only party to have that similar kind of refrain in the United States. But this is a big issue. And the growing movement is, just because I was born in a country, does that make my human right and my dignity any less? Because I was fortunate enough to be born in the United States, or you were fortunate enough to be born in the United Kingdom or in Australia, does that somehow make you a better person and more entitled to rights than a child who's born in a place like Bolivia, or a place like Rwanda, or a place like Malaysia, just by the happenstance of where a child was born? That is a real, hard, thorny, deep, philosophical, and human question. I'm not proposing that these answer it, but it does inform the work we do. Because if you take the point that all persons are persons, then is it fair that certain persons have services at their disposal just because? Just because. I didn't choose to be born in the United States of America. I'm glad I was, because I enjoyed the benefit of being American. Those of you who are Australian didn't choose to be born in Australia, but you enjoy the benefit of living in this country. But folks don't have that. And folks can't just leave. They can't just leave. And we're seeing what's created, being created in Europe, because people are trying to just leave. So, now, this, again, just it's a recapitulation that tracks the progress among different people groups, and notice in number 10, reduced inequality and among countries. That is a huge issue that just said that each country starts at a different point. Barring something I don't know, in my lifetime, I seriously doubt you're going to level the playing field of all countries. If for no other reason, the United States has 340 million people. It's unrealistic to think that a country that only has 1 million or 200,000, like an island, will have the same sort of infrastructure that a country. I mean, and that's not got anything to do with being ethnocentric. It's not beating a chest. It's just a reality. But what you can make more equal is the standard of living therein that comports with what the standard of living could and should be in that area. So, finally, these are the principles of the SDG. And when CIFAL Newcastle starts its programmatic strains, any CIFAL center, these are the things that will point to the strength of the programming that they do. The knowledge that you transfer, so let's put this in, say, the DRR context. Think about it all like this. The knowledge that you transfer, will it be able to be used on a national level? And will the nations, within their individual goals, vis-a-vis the 17, will it make sense for them? Every nation is now an owner of all 193. And so when you educate and train and do best practices, it has to make sense within their model. Inclusive and participatory. Again, not just governments, but corporations, foundations, civic society, charities, universities, the academic communities, think tanks. Everybody has something to do, at all ages. The UN is actually putting an enormous amount of infrastructure to reach young people who are even in high school, age 14, 13, 14, but especially university students. Presumption is, you take a liking to what's going on now, you'll translate that into your job. It applies to everybody, universality. This may be the greatest of the changes in the goals from millennium to sustainable. That all 190, and let me back up and say, this is a very critical point. This is the elephant in the room. These aren't required of any nation. Does anyone want to take a guess as to why they are not required of any nation? It wouldn't have gotten passed otherwise. Why? Because anything that becomes a compulsory act has to clear the Security Council. There are five members of the Security Council that have permanent veto, the United States, the United Kingdom, France, Russia, and China. The chances of these 17 not being pulled aside and having a veto exercised on one or two or seven or eight of them would be quite small if they were to be made compulsory. And that is a great drawback of the United Nations. There are very good policy reasons why that veto in the Security Council went into effect or was placed there. There are very good policy reasons why those five were the initial members and permanent members. It is left to debate whether that is still sound policy to have the same people who have veto and the same have permanent members at all within the Security Council, or to have a Security Council when you have a full chamber. That's above my pay grade. I don't know what the answer is. But I will say that the universality on a voluntary basis is a landmark of these goals. Leaving no one behind, which is almost cliched, one of the things that really they've taken to use the phraseology is reaching the furthest first. Those who are most isolated and left behind first. And we've talked about the human rights approach, which is integrated. Now, these ways, national ownership, participatory approach, universality, the furthest first, leaving no one behind, human rights, and integrated approach. These are what the United Nations hopes will spur more people to action in whatever those 17 goals are. And the United Nations also hopes that men and women will look at those 17 goals and say, they're not discrete. That I cannot help but do one thing that then has an effect like a spider web, boom, 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 and helps other things come to fruition. But I will say this before I do open the floor for any questions. Clearly, without any doubt, this set of goals is very aspirational. It's very high level. It can almost be overwhelmingly aspirational. However, by going underneath those aspirational 17 goals, and I don't have time to do it today, but I encourage you to go to the website and look, there are exceedingly specific metrics underneath that, and goals, targets, outcomes. By moving from the amorphous, blobby, bureaucratic speak down to let's do this via these ways, it becomes a transformative document in the United Nations history. And I think a transformative document in world history, because for the first time, the leaders of the entire planet came together and said, these are not just things that would be nice to work toward. These are existential goals for our planet, for our peace, for our prosperity, and for our people. And if we don't meet these existential goals, then in 15 years, when we look at what the 2045 agenda might be, we may be in a much darker and starker place. And that even though it is doubtful, this is not to pour water on anybody's enthusiasm, but even though it is doubtful that everything will be cured in 15 years, the premise of these goals is, if not now, when? If not this, what? And so that's why I would encourage you to think about what you can do. If you're a student, if you're a faculty member, if you're an administrator, if you're a staff member, if you're just a friend in the community, everyone can latch on to something. And I'm sure as CIFAL Newcastle becomes more robust after its initial entry into the system, there will be opportunities for you to partner with the center to effectuate and further these goals. So thank you for your attention. It's been lovely to be here with you. I'll turn it over to Graham, or I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you so much.